Troy, you as a curator of this exhibition, so after all, why to show an exhibition, to organize an exhibition with an architect first without showing any models too? So why? What's the concept of that? Without showing any art above all.
Right. Well, if you look at the history of architecture, who are the architects where you remember? Who are the architects that make a difference? Who are the architects that put a dent in culture? I think it's architects who have things to say about buildings.
About
buildings, about architecture, and about society. Because, of course, a building it's the physical institution that lasts multiple generations. So a building is not just design. It's economy, it's sociology, it's anthropology. It's all the aspects of what make us human and how we integrate ourselves into the world and be part of the world. So I think it's almost just the tip of the iceberg, design and buildings, models, maquettes, photographs of buildings. It's a tiny part of what real architects do. And I think Rem is one of the architects throughout his entire career. He started as a journalist and then he became known as a writer with Delirious New York. He's always been a writer. And in this case, what I thought was interesting was to invite him, after an entire career of looking almost exclusively at cities, to look at something entirely new. And not because he's an expert, but because I think he's a kind of versatile expert witness. He's truly incredible at being able to go into somewhere new, see something in a way where nobody has seen it that way before, and then he has the capacity to articulate it so that it becomes provocative.
Yeah, it's provocative because there's not even art, it's reproduction of art, which is the worst in a way, because most of the people can't make the difference between art and reproduction of art, and you encourage them in this case.
Well, think about it. You've got a fixed budget for an exhibition, right? And you have to think about, where's that money going to go? It's like being an architect. You have to decide what makes it into the project and what doesn't. And in this project, the art wasn't brought in the same way that you would experience an art exhibition, and it would never be treated that way because there's so much information. And what we decided was, instead of investing in the authenticity of the art, the art becomes a representative of a historical moment, but really the authenticity is actually in the artifacts coming from the countryside. So instead of a real Monet, we have a real satellite that's actually circling the globe, and a real drone that's actually killing predatory starfish in the Great Barrier Reef.
But so, what does it do for the emotion when you see a satellite?
I think what it does, so you can go to any museum in any city in the entire world and you can see art. Where can you see a real satellite? And that satellite is seeing you every single minute of every single day.
Yeah, but I don't need reciprocity with satellite.
I like the idea of reciprocity with satellite. I like the idea of the transparency of the technologies that are in our lives and making them different. Art participates in my life, but it doesn't structure it. Technology does. So right now you're asking me questions through a mobile phone.
Yeah.
We put those types of things on display in the show because we wanted people to see really what they are and actually present them in their authenticity, because for me personally, I would want you to look as closely at a satellite as you might look at a Monet.
Yeah, but the thing is that, for example, there's this reproduction of a millet of two country people praying, and I think there's a big emotion, and this structure, the real one, could structure my emotion.
Mm. Right. Well, in this case, here's the other question. So the vast majority of this exhibition is reproductions. It's printed out material. So if you bring in an object that has the aura of a real millet, what does that do to the rest of the show, and how does it reorganize it? I think in a curatorial practice, you have to think about almost, you know, it's a little bit like playing God. If you put too many planets or too many suns, you're going to swallow everything into a black hole. So you have to really distribute the gravity. So for us, I think the aura has been turned down in the show around the art so that the aura around the other objects we're most excited about presenting in this context can be turned up. So there's a robot that is used in Japan in the countryside in ways that humans never could be. Now you put that next to a spotlit Mie, and maybe you don't get the same feel from that robot, but you turn the aura down a little bit and other things get to shine. And I think that's what makes this exciting.
So it's an old way of making exhibition or a new way of making exhibition?
It's both. I mean, think about the salon. The original kind of salons, or the original, these images that you see of the Louvre, you know, 200 and something years ago, there's a million paintings on the wall. And in this case, we also have this kind of high drama of almost full saturation. We've taken almost every kind of nook and cranny, every corner of the building and all of its personality, and attempted to insert information and spectacle at the same time. Something that's made to give you a sense of awe at the world we actually live in, but also gives you the didactic kind of footholds to dive in and learn something as you go.
Merci.
Okay.